All right, so basically, this is a session to give a crash course in Drupal. I will go at full speed, but because the session is being recorded, you'll have access to video, so therefore you can read or sorry, rewind and pause and see whatever I'm doing. So here, I already have Drupal installed, and I'm going to reinstall, like rebuild the site with. So right now, behind you, there is this, you see the browser. By the way, feel free to ask questions, but I will still try to go as fast as I can. So here, I'm going to do drush SQL drop, and that basically drops all my tables, and that means I don't have anything anymore. Then I say drush site install. And that rebuilds the site from scratch. And hopefully, at the end of it, I will have a site. Alright, so that installed the site. It's an empty site. If I log in, this is the standard Drupal toolbar and the shortcut menu and everything. So I'm going to instead disable some of the modules that I don't particularly like. So I have a shell alias for that and enable some that I do like. So these are, basically the what I'm disabling are overlay, dashboard, toolbar, RDF, comment, shortcut, and update modules. They're not that they are bad modules, it's just that they are not useful, very useful on a dev site. And then I enabled these admin menu toolbar, devel generate, and module filter. These are things that are very useful to a developer. So if I now refresh the site, I have the admin menu, and this menu is added by devel. And then when you go to modules, you have module filter. This is added by module filter. And then finally, because I enabled devel generate, I can now generate content and users and terms and everything, which is exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to first, because my site is completely empty, as you can see, there is nothing there. No users also, no terms. So I'm going to generate some content. So here comes the generate terms. Let's start with terms, 10 terms. Then generate some users. Okay. Sure, 50 users. It's a bit much, but okay. Then generate some content. I will generate only article content. Okay. So we generate some content. So at the end of it, now we have a bunch of content. I want you to also, I have written a document. So let me share this link with you. So hold on, I'm sharing the link. Okay, so I'm going to paste the link into the Hangout. Where is my Hangout? Okay. Where is my Hangout? I cannot find my Hangout window. Okay, here. So, okay, I pasted a link in the Hangout window. You can, and I'll also paste it in the other chat. Okay. So, this is roughly what I want to cover. So let's get started. First, let's talk about the request lifecycle. So, how does Drupal, remember this is a Drupal crash course in the sense that it's for a developer. So which means as a developer you need to know how it works. Okay? So let's also consider how the whole thing works. when you Drupal is located in this place, this is my Drupal root, home dev Drupal 7, and every request is mapped to index.php. Okay, so that's the dispatcher, front-end dispatcher. And when I go and visit, let's say, this modules path, so I'm going to admin modules, what is really happening is that it turns that admin modules path into index dot, I mean, when I say it, I mean nginx, index.php question mark q is equal. So this is how the request is converted. From the original incoming request was just slash admin slash modules. That was the URL. But then Nginx or Apache will rewrite it into this. Or Nginx in Drupal 7's case will rewrite it into this. Either way, you have to understand that every request, each and every, no exception, that bootstraps Drupal, that is handled by Drupal, goes through index.php. That's one thing. Now, there is some exception to that, only because these images, these are static resources. So if you look at this inspect element and look at the image here, so let me just open the image in new window. Open image in new tab, yeah. So here, if you see the URL, this is a static file. It actually exists. If it did not exist, Drupal would still handle it. So if I actually look for this path, ls-l, so it does exist. A static file that does exist will be served directly by the web server. But since it is a style image, in the absence of it not existing, like in the case that it doesn't exist, index.php will still receive the request and actually generate the file, the image, on the fly and then serve it. So that's very nice. So that's how the first time generation is done by Drupal handling it, and all subsequent times it is the web server simply detects that the file exists and serves it directly. That makes the whole thing very fast. Okay, so if you look at the document, it says the request lifecycle, all requests are routed through index.php. First thing Drupal does is bootstrap itself, which means figure out which site you are in, what your connection parameters are, connect to the database, and then start looking for some basic database settings, variables. Okay, that's what bootstrapping is. On number three, the path, which is in this case, if I click on this, so the node 49 in this case, that path is passed to index.php as Q parameter, okay? And then it activates the original handler, the real handler that is supposed to handle it. So in case of node 49, the handler will be node view handler, okay? And so it looks at the path and activates the correct handler on that. And then finally, the node view handler runs. Oh, before it actually passes it in, it checks for access permissions. So it calls it an access callback function, which basically determines if the currently logged in user or anonymous user has access to this content or not. And then finally, it executes the menu handler, which generates the body of this page. Or whatever page you might be looking at. And then the very final step is whatever the body or the data array, data structure that was returned by the page callback, it gets delivered back to the browser using a delivery callback, which usually converts PHP arrays into HTML content, which is otherwise known as theming or rendering. Okay, all right. So that's the life cycle. I hope you got an idea of how the request is processed. Then I want to, because again, this being a crash course, I want to give you a a lot of information in a very short time. So that means you should know Drush also. Again, this is not for a complete newbie. It is for people who have some exposure to Drupal, and you guys have been using Drush already. So, okay. So the what are the commands you would need to know about Drush? You can just type Drush, and it will list every command there is. So since it's a pretty long output, generally I just grep for whatever I'm looking for. So you just say Drush, and then pipe grep for
site. One thing I want to say.
Yeah?
Well, we can only see your web browser window. If you're supposed to be able to see your console window,
Oh, sorry. Let me fix that. Okay, unfortunately, it's going to share entire screen. All right, well. So I have dual screen, dual. So do you see everything? You probably
yes,
see too much.
We see both screens. Yeah.
Yeah. That. So that's why I'm going to do something else. Hold on. Unfortunately, it's not going to. Okay, I have to share the entire screen only. Or I can turn off my second monitor. Hold on. That didn't work. Okay, hold on. I need to pause the video recording. Okay, so if I say just Drush, it will start. It will. It will print so much. So therefore, I typically say Drush. And then pipe and grep for whatever I am looking for. Like, for example, site install. Okay. So, these are the... So, the first thing you want to do, first command you want to learn is Drush status. So, that's Drush status. And it shows you the status of Drush as well as status of the Drupal site. So, that's why it is... showing you some database, the name of the database you're connected to, and you know the site directory, files directory, etc., etc. Okay. Then the other commands are also in here. You can download a project. Drush CC all is very, very useful. But CC, you can just say CC and choose which one you want to clear. We use CC quite all very often, but you don't have to. So you can be more selective. So for example, I say Drush CSS and JS. Only CSS, JS, JavaScript cache is cleared. So it's sometimes faster. Very handy on slow machines or very heavily loaded servers. So then you download a project, you enable a module from that project, so Drush EN. These are some examples. Okay, and then vset is variable set. So for example, you can say Drush vget site underscore name, and it's Drupal Scratchpad. Right, so that's the name of the site, and I can change it. I can say Drush vset site name equal to demo site, let's say. I just change that. Once I do that, I reload, and that changed. So it was just a variable. So changing a variable from the command line. So Drush is very useful for a lot of these things. You need to be aware that, and oh, by the way, Dress site install, which I showed in the very beginning. You guys were able to see that, right? Site install? Were you able to see site install when I did that?
I think that was also when the browser was showing.
Okay, so but that's okay. I mean, you all have to. Once you have a settings.php, once you have a settings.php, it is simply a matter of. So it's easy to create the settings.php from a graphical install, browser-based install, and then from that point onward, you can just use Drush site install because it will use the same settings.php, which means all the. Otherwise, you would have to say Drush site install dburl, and then you have to give your MySQL URL in there. An example is already in the document. Okay. Now, the other thing you need to know about is that there is a drush.rc file, and the drush.rc is system-wide drush.rc is etc drush contains this drush.rc file, and then you can have your own .drush directory which can contain drush.rc file. So this will be user-specific, not system-wide. And then each site can have, in the site directory, you can have drush.rc. Sites all can have drush.rc. And so there are a lot of places where you can put drush.rc files. Anyway, aliases.drush.rc.php is also very useful because if I show you my system-wide aliases.drush.rc, so it shows some of the sites that I typically use. Okay, so you can give a short name to your drush.rc file. Okay, all right. So short name to your Drush sites, you know, Drush managed sites, basically. And then finally, registry rebuild. The other day, somebody had moved their modules around, and suddenly the site stopped working because now Drupal is not able to bootstrap itself. It doesn't know where are certain modules that it requires because you moved them. So you can download this Drush plugin called registry rebuild, and then call it using Drush RR, and that will make Drupal figure out where these modules are and you know, be able to start. Okay, now let's talk about Drupal directory structure. So I want to start a file browser and then show you what the directory structure looks like. So this is Drupal 7 directory. Let me let me show you what the directory structure looks like. So you have view list. How do you say view? A detailed list, yeah. Okay, yeah. So you say, so all these things, everything in here is off limits except sites. This is the only place where you should be. Do keep in mind index.php is there, of course, and there is .htaccess and robots.txt and all those things. You might modify robots.txt, but generally I would recommend against it. You should just have your own copy and have Nginx or Apache serve that second copy rather than modifying anything in Drupal distribution. So then you go into sites. This is where you should be doing all modifications. And as you can see, once I do site install, my default directory is also read-only, which is a good thing. And so site, if you look at this document here, all the modules and themes and libraries and profile in Drupal root should be left alone. Okay. And then only in sites you should play. There also in sites, all modules and themes, you can put shared modules, libraries, and themes. I generally don't like to. I prefer every site to have its own copy of modules and themes so that they can all have different versions if they want. So then finally, sites/your site directory. This is obviously the main place where you should be doing anything in general. And so the structure of that directory is, if I say tree to stop. So if I now run tree, so okay, so this is a lot of stuff. So the tree is not very useful. If I just say ls minus la, so I have files, libraries, modules, scripts, themes, and then two files called default.settings.php and settings.php. Default.settings.php comes with Drupal distribution. Settings.php does not. You just copy it from that, and then you put your database information in there. Of course, all that is done by either Drupal Trush site install or by Drupal's graphical installer, browser-based. The main thing I want to show you is what's in modules. So if you see, in modules, you have contrib, custom, and features. So this is the standard structure that you should all follow. Contrib is where you download new modules. Custom is where you write new modules, your own. And then features is where you export features and configuration modules. Okay. All right, so the final thing I want to show in the directory structure is in the sites directory, there is sites.php. Of course, in my case, there isn't. So I would have to copy example.sites.php into sites.php. Okay, and then in sites.php, you can do all your mapping. So if I wanted to map, you know, sites, some foo.localhost into a directory called xyz, I would do it like this. So this would be site directory mapping. Anyway, I'm not going to do that, so let me remove my sites.php. Okay, I still have examples.sites.php. Okay, you should read what's at the top of this file. It describes all the rules, the default rules. Even in the absence of proper mapping data, it will use these rules to map from the URL to the site directory. And that's very important. Of course, the URL is going to take you to a specific site, and you should be able to predict which site, because based on that, it's going to select what database, credentials, etc. Okay, all right, let's keep going. Now, let's dive straight into module development. Again, this might be going too fast, but that's the whole point, going fast. So, let's go to default, let's create a module. CD, I want CD, I'll just say mkdir custom, sorry, modules custom, and my mod. Okay, that's the name of the module. That's the machine name. So in Drupal module development, you have to realize that you should never modify Drupal core or someone a module written by someone else. You should not modify the code of that, of such modules. You should instead either, I mean, the right way is to write your own module that simply exploits the appropriate hooks and gets your code in the right place in Drupal's request processing lifecycle flow, and then you know, modifies the data just right, just appropriately, so that now the Drupal behavior is modified. That's basically by writing modules and maybe themes sometimes. In some rare cases, when there is a bug that can only be fixed by modifying some code in either Drupal core or in Drupal contrib modules, you should create a change and generate a patch and submit the patch to whatever project that you are fixing. Okay, and then re-download that patch as part of your Drush make, and that's the right way to do it. Don't just make some changes, because over time when you update your modules, your changes will be lost, or you won't be able to update modules. Both are not good. Okay, so let's talk about how do you modify Drupal's behavior. You basically you implement hooks. Drupal core as well as contrib modules, they declare hooks. And your job is to implement some of these hooks based on which part of the request lifecycle you want to manipulate. So I will start with a very basic, simple module. I say, let me do this in NetBeans because it will be easier for everybody to understand what's going on. So I go to sites, default, modules, custom, my mod, and I will create a file. Let me do it faster. I can do it faster with VI. So touch modules, custom, my mod, my mod dot info. So every module must have an info file, and then almost all modules have a module file also. A module won't be able to do anything without a dot module file. Okay, so dot info file contains the human readable name of the module. So this is my demo module. Description: this is a module just for demo purposes. Okay, and then you must specify core, which Drupal core version it works with. So 6, 7, 8, whatever it is, right? And then you can specify dependencies. So you can say that in order for me to work, I require devel, let's say, module to be there, because I'm about to, in my module implementation, I'm going to use a function that comes with devel. So I say that, and I could say more things, but let's stop here. So I save this, and then in the dot module file, you have to put, you start with PHP, and then you put your PHP code here, and make sure you don't close PHP. Again, make sure you do not close PHP, because if you close it, then there is a potential that there'll be some extra stuff, or just even white space after it, which will get printed to the HTML page. So you don't want that. So just leave it at that. Let me just, because it is not recognizing PHP, I have to close it and reopen it, and now it should recognize PHP. Okay, so function, now at this point we have a module. The module doesn't do anything. So let's save it and see if we even have a module. We go to our Drupal site, go to modules, and in other, because I did not specify any categorization for my module, it went to other. If I want to specify a category, I could say, I could put it under development, okay? So then to specify a category, you say package equals development. Let's see. So once I do that and I refresh, my module showed up under the development category. Okay? So I'm going to enable it, save configuration. Obviously, my module doesn't do anything whatsoever. So it has no code, but it's a legitimate module. It has an info file. Anything that has an info file is legitimate. Okay. Even the module file is empty. Now I'm going to implement a hook. Drupal, you should go to api.drupal.org and then see what hooks it provides. So I am going to use a hook called hook init. So that's the hook. I search. The hook init is basically one of the very early on hooks that executes at the very beginning of the request processing lifecycle. Actually, there is another one called hook boot, which happens even before that. But that's before the user's identity is established, everything at the beginning of the very bootstrap cycle. While hook init is bootstrapping and user identity access control, they are all done. And now this is just, they're about to generate the page. So that's when hook init will happen. So now what I'm going to do is, whenever you want to implement a hook, you copy the full signature. Remember, this is a very simple hook, but then there are other hooks like for example, hook form alter, right? They have several parameters. So what you should do is basically copy the whole thing and then paste it into your code. Put the word function in front of it. Replace the word hook with your module's machine name, my mod. And then now you basically have a proper hook with the proper signature, right? So I'm not trying to implement this one. I'm trying to implement hook init. So for me, the right process will be copy this, paste it here, give it a body, but then replace the word hook with my mod. Okay? All right, so this is my hook. Let me now, all I have to do is, I have to say something here. So I could basically put a Drupal set message, and I could put a message, hello from demo module. Okay, so this is your Drupal message. Okay, and then let's see if this works. So I go back to my site and go to the home page, or anywhere. I mean, it should work anywhere. So if I go to the home page, it doesn't work because I need to remember, whenever you introduce a new hook like this one, Drupal is caching every existing hook. So because you introduce a new hook, Drupal is not aware that a new hook has been introduced. So you have to flush caches. Now, if you already had the hook in the module and you just enabled the module, then there's no problem because it recognizes this is a new module. So it scans it for all hook implementations. But when an existing module adds a new hook, you have flush caches. So there we have our message, hello from demo module. So what we will do now is, instead of saying simple hello like this, we will use DPM. Remember, this is the reason why I said my module depends on devel module, because devel module provides DPM. DPM, Drupal or devel print message. And then what I'm going to do is, I'm just going to print something. Let's say I print the request object. And then you can give it a label. So I'll say request. So what I'm basically doing is printing the request object. So if I save this and reload, there's your DPM printing request object. Looks like I made a mistake in how I specified request. No? Well, it didn't print. Request doesn't seem to contain anything. So let me try $get. Okay. See what happens. Get object. Reload. Okay. So this request is from last time. I don't know why it's still stuck. And the get is also being printed twice. So I'm not quite sure why. There must be two requests executing. That's why. What is happening is, there is a second request going on that is also reaching Drupal. And that's why this is happening twice. But in any case, as you can see, this is the second request. The admin menu cache, JS admin menu cache, blah, 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 is a second request. But then the main request that we are looking at is q equal to node. You see that? Because I'm on the page that says node. So q, and this is what I told you at the beginning, that index.php question mark q equal to your route path is what Drupal sees. So as you can see, that's the query parameter Drupal received. Okay. So back to our notes. The Drupal will define a whole bunch of hooks. You can see the list of hooks here on api.drupal.org, and you start typing something and it will show you a whole bunch of hooks. Okay. If you are interested in how to alter a form, so here you say form underscore alter, and there you find hook form alter search. So let us implement that one more hook. Okay. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to get to the see, for example, this is the search form. So I'm going to figure out what is the form ID of this search form, and here form ID will be a hidden variable somewhere inside the form. So here's the form. Form contains a bunch of things, and here's form build ID, form token, and form ID. There it is. Search block form is this. is the form ID. So what I can do is I can implement a new hook. First, I have to go and copy the API, this hook signature, hook form alter. I copy this, I go back to my code and I say function paste, and then I replace the name hook with my mod. Save it. At this point, I can, you know, I'm going to switch to VI for this, because NetBeans is not actually doing syntax highlighting and all that. So let me just switch to VI for this. If I say modules custom my mod dot module, yeah, see, this is, hopefully this is more readable. Okay, so my mod form alter, and before I do anything else, I'm just going to DPM the parameters I'm getting. So form state and form ID. Okay, so if I DPM these and I go back to my site and refresh, once again I don't get what I want to see, which is my hook implementation executing. But that's because it's a new hook implementation. I have to clear cache. Before I do that, I'm going to disable this one. I don't want to see that. Okay. All right. So now if I flush cache, one more reload. Okay. So here I see form, form state, and form ID search block form, like I expected. But this is not just specific to this form. You go to another place, like for example, modules page, and there you go, a different form ID, system modules, which is describing this form. This whole page has a form. If I go to node add article, add content article, here's another one, form ID article node form. And it describes what all the goodies that the hook is receiving. So let's get back to the front page and the search form. This is the one that we will modify. If I look at the, one more reload, if I look at the form, it says search block form has, this is a key, remember this is dollar form structure, okay? So in under that you have, you know, title, which is the title of the search block form. And you have a bunch of other things. What I'm going to do is I want to just add some text, or I want to give a default value within search. Okay, so what I will do is go to the form actions, form build ID, all these things are there, form token. There should be a search string or input there. Do you see the struct search input? I am not even, maybe it's inside the actions or someplace. I see submit. Where is the input? I don't have very good eyes. Build ID, form ID, token, action. Huh.
Is there that default value up at the top?
Where is the default value up at the top?
Yeah.
This. But it's blank. No, that's not the one. Oh, maybe it is. Hold on. What is the type? Oh, yes, it is. Absolutely. You are absolutely right. It is text field. So search block form is of, this is that input field. And then, yes, the default value is blank, so I can change it. So now that I've understood the structure of this form, that dollar form has search block form and it has default value with the pound sign in front, I can now manipulate. I can basically go in there and say dollar. So remember, I'm receiving dollar form by reference. Therefore, I can simply say dollar form and this name paste and pound default value. And I can say your search string just a search string. Okay. I save this. Once I save it, and to there you go. I just modified the form. Okay. I could do some more fancy things like, let's see what else is in there. Search block form has, it does have a title already. I was about to change the title, but looks like styling is hiding the title. So that's not going to help. I could add a new field altogether. For example, I could just say $form foo equals array. Now here at this point, you have to know Forms API, which by the way is in the notes, how to use Forms API, but I'm just going to say type is equal to, let's say, checkbox. Title equals something, my title. And then value equals my value. Let's see what happens. So if I do this, it added a new checkbox. And the label is my title. And the internal value, we'll find out through inspect element, is value is equal to 1, actually. So it doesn't work the way I thought it does. But okay, you have to specify it. I mean, you can read the Forms API and see how checkboxes are given values. But that's okay. Okay. So, this is how you use Drupal hooks. That was a super fast, quick way to describe what Drupal hooks are, what they can do. They can do a lot. I mean, you have to understand that they can do a whole bunch. Okay? So, I already described what a module consists of, the info file, the module file. Also, it can have a .install file in which you will have a hook schema or something like that, which builds tables that the module will use in case your module has its own custom tables. And then it's a good practice. A lot of people don't early on, but they stuff all of their module code into the .module file, okay, into this file alone. So it's okay. Initially, it's fine to do that. But as your module grows, basically, you should not keep anything other than your main hook implementations in .module file. And those hook implementations should load extra files as .inc include files, which contain PHP code that is relevant not in 100% of the requests, but maybe some requests. For example, you happen to be on the correct form ID, etc. By the way, I made a huge mistake here. I was doing this, adding this, making these changes everywhere on every form. That's a big mistake. I need to fix that. What I should be doing is, I should be checking for form ID. So form ID is search block form. So I should specifically be looking for that. I should say, if $form ID is equal to that, then only you should do these things. Right? Make sense? So if I save this, now it hopefully will continue to work it continues to work for this, but it doesn't affect other forms such as, say, article. Okay? And so it doesn't affect those. Otherwise, without checking for form ID, it would. Okay. All right, so let's keep going. This was, module development. Now, this is just a beginning, but you can do a lot more using these basic principles. You should learn the Drupal API using api.drupal.org. You should learn the database abstraction layer. Again, same place. Forms API is on the same place. And Forms API is very extensive, so you need to read more about it. So here are some of the commonly implemented hooks. I should implement hook menu once so that you guys have some idea of how to implement your own page. Okay, so let me implement hook menu so that. Okay, so hook menu is one of the most important hooks. it is not only about menus. It is about all pages and routes. When I say route, I mean the path that's in the after the host name. So, which means, in this case, the route is node add article. Okay, so hook menu, you just say, hook menu has no signature, so you could just say my mod menu. I mean, it's an empty signature, empty function. And then you should probably put a comment up there saying implements hook underscore menu. It's a good practice. And then you may say specific to your implementation, like adds new routes, and then specify which routes. Okay. So the one thing that you do is you return an array called $items. Of course, you haven't built it, so let's build it. You could say empty array like this, but PHP is forgiving. You can just start, if you even start by adding stuff to the array, it is okay. It's fine with that. So the first line is unnecessary. Okay, so now let's start adding. So let's remove that. Okay, now this is your route. The key of the items array is your route. So I will create something called my mod. One second. Yeah. My mod slash page one, let's say. Okay, that's the thing I'm adding. And then I say page callback. This is the most important thing. Page callback is the function that will return the body of the page. Okay. So before I even do that, let me just add a title. Title is say my page one. I can say my mod page one. Okay. So title is an attribute. So dollar items, basically each element of dollar item is supposed to be a route, and the route path is this, and then the rest of it is the parameters. So you add this title. Let's see what happens if anything happens at all. I will have to flush all caches. Nothing really happened. The reason why is because nobody, not even administrator, is allowed to access this path. So in order to open up the access control, security checks, I have to add access callback. And then you can say who is allowed to access. You should read the documentation of hook menu, and it will tell you what various values are possible. Right now I'll take the easy way out and just set the access callback to true. A Boolean value of true basically means everyone is allowed. Okay, so now let's save this. And once again, I don't have to flush all caches. I did not add a new hook, but I did modify a menu item. So I have to clear at least the menu cache. I did that, and that still doesn't do anything. Let me try to actually visit the path, my mod page one, if I can see it. Access is still denied. Okay, so I think maybe because there is no page callback. So let's add a page callback. And page callback is the name of the function, the function that will generate the body of this page. Okay, so I will say, I'll give it a name, my mod page one. Now rather than my mod page one, I will give it a name, because this can be confused as hook page one. Somebody might think that this is a hook implementation. Remember, in hooks, you replace the word hook with the machine name of the module that is implementing it. So in order to remove that confusion, I will put an underscore in front of this. So this basically will, now I create that function, underscore my mod page one. And from that, of course, I can return a nice renderable array. But for now, I will just return a string, and that will say hello my mod. Let us see if this works. reload. Of course, I have to clear the menu cache at least. Here you go. So that's your title that you specified. This is the body of the page that you're returning from your page callback. And as a bonus, it also got added to the navigation menu. So that's the Drupal's default behavior. When you specify a new menu item, it ends up in the navigation menu. A lot of times you don't want a menu item at all, or maybe you want it in the main menu. So if you wanted this to be added to the main menu, you would say menu, and then this will be main menu, I think. Let's see if this works. Again, because I can just say drush cc menu. That's the menu cache cleared. And now it didn't actually move that. Let me see. Menu is, okay. Let me flush all caches. It didn't even disappear from there, for that matter. So it, okay, well, you can see that here in hook menu. Hook menu will tell you how exactly this works. And these are the callback arguments. One of them will be menu name. Ah, it's not menu, but menu name. It is, yeah, I guess. So menu underscore name, not menu. So I would say menu underscore name, main menu. Whatever the machine name of the main menu is. So let me make sure that the machine name is also what. So I can go to structure, menus, main menu. If I hover on it, yes, it is main hyphen menu. Okay. So now if I clear all cache, it's gone from the navigation menu and it got moved to main menu. You see that? Okay. So that's how I moved the menu item from out of the navigation menu into main menu. But a lot of times you don't want any menu item at all, in which case you have to say the type. You say type menu callback. By default, this thing is menu normal item. But normal item means an item with an actual physical menu presence, menu link in it. But in menu callback, basically means no physical visible menu at all. Just a route that somebody can reach if they want to. So if they know about it, basically, or if they have a link to it. So now if I flush the cache, only the menu cache, let's say. So, oops, didn't do it. Flush all cache again. I think I'm doing something wrong. Let me check the menu type. Menu normal item, yes. Menu callback, yeah, that's correct. So it didn't actually, hold on. Menu name, type, menu callback. Oh, wait, I think once it gets introduced into the menu system, it doesn't go away by itself. If I now reload, yeah, it doesn't go away by itself. So I have to structure, menus, main menu. Okay, no, it's not deletable. So I'm not sure why it's not disappearing. It should. But if I introduce another one, let's say page 2, I'm going to copy and paste this. And I'll call it page 2. And this is page 2. This is page 2. Callback is true. And I say type is menu callback. Hopefully. Let me remove this. So the second one at least didn't show up, as you can see. The menu, my mod page 2 didn't show up. My mod page 1 is still there, but if you change the route to page 2, it crashed. White screen. Because I don't have my mod page 2 as a function yet. Sorry. I need to create that. So I create page 2. And hello page 2 is what we will say there. Okay. Now if I go back again, flush cache. So page 2 is not shown. Okay, good. Now if I change the URL to page 2. So page 2 is working, as you can see. See? So the second page is working, but there is no menu item for it. That's because it was a callback. The other one, I don't know, it somehow remembers that it was menu item, so it keeps showing it. We can disable our module. If I disable the module, Drush, disable my mod. Hopefully then it will remove it from the menu. Yeah, it's gone from the menu, right? So now if I bring it back, I enable it again. My hope is that it doesn't bring it back. Yeah, it didn't bring it back. So you see, no main menu doesn't have that my page one. Okay. I think that's the time we are going to spend on module development. I just wanted to show you what all you need to do to create pages. And of course, I did not go discuss security much at all. We simply took the easy way out and said access callback true. In reality, there is some access control. Okay. All right. So let's keep going. Like as I said, this is a crash course, so we need to keep going at full speed. So this was about module development. You have to learn a lot of hooks. And if you want to see some examples, you can Drush DL examples. This is a very good module. It has lots of examples. If you now go into your Drupal site, so there's all these examples are there. So you can go through these example modules and learn how to do module development. These are all the various situations. Okay. So now let's go to theme development. Okay. So theming, as I said, is the process of converting a data structure into HTML. Okay. Drupal code, the page callbacks generally are supposed to return data structures. I mean, specifically known as render arrays. And you, as a themer, most modules that return render arrays also either are returning render arrays using standard theming hooks, or they provide their own theming hooks. So most modules know how to render themselves their own data, right? Not most, all. But then your theme, when you implement a theme, you may want to tweak how the rendering happens. You may want to modify it. So that's what we will do. But even in there, you have to realize that theming is 90% styling, 10% theming, really. Which means only 10% of the time you're really tweaking the HTML that is generated. 90% of the time you're just adding CSS and making it look different. Okay. So let's start with a theme. I will use Bootstrap as an example, but you can use your own. So Drush DL Bootstrap gives you downloading the Bootstrap theme. Yep. So now I can use the Bootstrap theme itself, but that was not the intent. The intent is to create a sub theme. So let us do just that. So the Bootstrap theme comes with a subdirectory that contains a ready to go sub theme. That. So I'm going to say cp-r themes bootstrap to Bootstrap sub theme from there to themes my my boot. Okay, let's just call it that. So I copied that. I should open it, themes my boot, and then there is all the stuff. The main thing I need to do is I need to rename this Bootstrap sub theme info starter kit 2 themes, my boot, and then the machine name of the theme, which generally would be same as the directory name, myboot.info. And let's vi that, themes, myboot.info, sorry. And here you have the human readable name. You can just say my you do have to specify the base theme, which they have helpfully already set to Bootstrap, and then a Bootstrap sub theme and all that. So this is now the child theme inherits most of the things from the parent theme, except it doesn't inherit regions. You have to specify the regions all over again. So that's why you have to, even though this might be a copy of those regions, you still have to specify them. It does inherit style sheets, but then you can add your own. So it is my habit to, okay, before I go, I'll come back to style sheets, but let's just see, keep going where. So you can add your own JavaScript scripts like this. And then settings, you can customize some settings. So what settings are available is defined by the parent theme. Of course, you can add your own. Okay. Settings are basically sort of like Drupal variables, but these are variables only within the theme. Okay, so we did this. Let's save this. Now let's talk about that style sheet thing again. So style sheets all. So this is an array, not an array really, but array-like thing, where you have a key, a symbol, and then which media does this apply to? All means everything, including screens, print media, as well as screen readers. And then empty square brackets indicate that I am adding to a list, and this is what I'm adding. Okay, so now what I want to check is, in the original Bootstrap theme, which is our base theme, it still has some influence, right? So if I look at the bootstrap.info, I want to see what style sheet it has. Style sheets. It has no styles. Really? How can that be? Okay, I guess. I think it does have some styles. And now if I look at the themes, myboot.css, and there is the style.css, which is an empty file, by the way, because this is where you will inherit all of Bootstrap's stuff, and then you can add your own. Okay. So let me show you how that will work. First, we have to enable this theme. So we go to appearance. And in appearance, you have Bartik 7, and then you got two icons of Bootstrap. One is the original Bootstrap, the other is your sub-theme. So I will enable and set default. So that makes your sub-theme the default theme, and this, it makes your sub theme look exactly like Bootstrap theme itself. Okay, so you got the top menu bar like that, and you got wells and, you know, nice gray highlighted areas like that. And so this is standard Bootstrap looking, and this is your pager, Bootstrap styled. The thing is, you haven't made any customizations yet, so that's the next thing you can do. To customize, let us say you wanted to, I don't know, change the way, let's do something very, very basic and simple. All hyperlinks, you want to show them in a different color. Okay, that's all. So we'll start there. So you can just go to this CSS file and say let's say on hover, they should become italicized. So you say font style italics. So this means all ahref tags, when you hover on them, they become italicized. Is it italics or italic? I don't know. We'll find out. If I reload, that didn't quite do. Flush caches. Nope, that didn't do. Okay, let me check what I need to do to make something italicized. Font style. It's italic. Yeah, that was the problem. So I need to make it italic. That's the way to do it. So now if I reload, oh, there you go. So I hover on any hyperlink and it becomes italicized. So this is a very basic thing. Now you can say font decoration none. I don't know why. Yeah. Text decoration? Sorry. Text decoration none. Which means right now it creates an underline. And once I refresh, it will not create the underline. No underline. Okay. So these are some of the basic things you are doing. More importantly, you're using Bootstrap. You can do a lot more. We'll get to it. The point is, with this, you get the benefit of all the goodies that Bootstrap provides. And yet you have some control over your styles. So this way you do mostly styling. And then I need to tell you that if you ever get around to doing real theming, you will be doing it in your themes template.php file. So this is where you do theming. This is where you write theme overrides. Okay, theme implementation overrides only for functions, not for TPL files. For TPL files, you have a different place, and that is your themes templates directory. This is where you put TPL files. So if you want to override the template of something, let me see. Let's say on every actual node detail page, so this is a node detail page, I want to, I don't know, customize it for whatever reason. Okay, so in order to do that, I should first see if there is a node.tpl.php in my base theme. So let's see. This base theme is theme/template somewhere. Okay, well, let me just do this. Let me just say find in my Bootstrap anything by the name *.tpl.php. Okay, so there it is. So Bootstrap theme, Bootstrap, blah, blah, blah. So I'm looking for node.tpl.php. You see it? I don't see it. Okay. So there is no node.tpl.php. That means, or let's say block. Let's customize the block. So I copy this block. I want to show you that first how you customize something that is customized by your base theme, and then something that is not customized by your base theme, which means it's coming from Drupal root. So let's start with block. So as you know, this is a block, right? So if you wanted to put an extra div around the block or something like that, I just want to show you how to do that. I copy the original block.tpl.php into my themes templates directory. Okay, then I open it and I can make whatever changes I like. So I'm going to basically just do something like put a new div around it, okay? And I will call div. Normally, you're not supposed to put any style attribute directly here, but since I'm just demoing it, it's okay to do that. So I say border solid red 1 pixel. So with this, every block should receive a red border. Let's see if it does. Of course, it doesn't until I flush caches. There you go. This is a block. Navigation menu is a block. That main area is a block powered by Drupal. Every block, has a red border around it across the board. Okay, so if you wanted to do it for a specific block only, not all blocks, you would have to rename the file to include the block ID. So those are called theming hook suggestions. So rules, basically, you can be more specific that not every block is specific block. So you can basically say, here's the block ID. Where's the block ID? There, block search form, right? So that's the block ID. You can basically, you can use that in the name of the TPL file, and I won't go into that. You have to search it. Search for theme hook suggestions, and then you will find out how to use those. Okay. Anyway, so this was block which was not customized. What if I wanted to customize? It was block was customized by Bootstrap, the base theme. So you copy from the base theme. But if node.tpl.php is not customized by any theme, then it is in Drupal core. Therefore, if I want to customize it, I say copy my Drupal root / and now look for node.tpl.php. I don't know where it is, so I'm just going to do find again and say name is node.tpl.php. And I found it in Bartik, which is not meaningful for us. Bartik is not my base theme. Garland, again, same problem. But here's the Drupal core. Modules node has node.tpl.php. That's the one I am currently using. So I copy that into theme, my boot templates. Okay. Now when I look at it, theme, my themes, templates, node tpl.php. So that's the node tpl.php. Of course, there's a lot of comments, documentation comments, so that's good. Now if I want, just for fun, I will put a blue border around all nodes, just to show you, right? Dev style border is solid blue 1 pixel, right? Now in reality, if you just wanted to add a border, you don't have to do any of these things. You can just style it properly. But this is me showing you how to modify the HTML. So I saved this and I clear cache. And you see red and blue border, both. Red because it's a block, and blue because it's a node. So if I go to front page, you see every node has blue border around it. And if you go to the node page, it has a blue border, and then that has a red border around it because you are also in a block, content block. Okay, so this is theming and styling. Let's keep going. Remember, crash course. You do need to learn about SAS and LESS. And if there is nothing I can tell you about SAS and LESS, let me first check that I have SAS or LESS. Okay, I don't have SAS and LESS C, so I won't be showing you that. But you do need to know that SAS and LESS make CSS development very easy and more organized, more efficient. Okay, so you can read about them online. These are meta compilers, basically. They compile from SAS and LESS languages to CSS language, which of course the browser can use. All right, so these are some common base themes: Bootstrap, Xen, Omega, Adaptive, Foundation, and there are many more. So you can go to drupal.org and see which themes are most popular. Just to show you how to see popularity, you can just go to drupal.org and go to download and extend. And then you see modules, most installed, new modules, themes, etc. So if you go to search for more themes, and here they are already showing them most installed, Xen being number one, omega number 2, and like that it goes. Bootstrap, as you can see, adaptive, corporate, clean, Marinelli. So all these are there. So this tells you which are. So you obviously should go from the most common themes to less and less. And then similarly, you can do for the same thing for modules. You can say most installed modules, and that'll show you. Some of these modules are most installed. For example, Token is most installed, not because Token is popular, but it is a requirement of some popular modules. So that's why it's always installed. Same thing with C-Tools. Okay. Okay. So that's how you know, you find out which are the modules and themes you need to know about. Let's go back to our notes, and here. The rest of the presentation will focus on learning modules. Remember, you don't write in Drupal. The whole point is not to write a whole lot of code. So you should not be writing a lot of code. If everything should not be custom module, because there are lots of good modules out there. You should be, even if they don't fulfill 100% of your requirement, you should use it. If they do help you rather than hurt you, so use that. And then add the delta, add the missing parts. And that makes it very efficient development. Okay. And there are huge number of modules. I mean, I don't know how many modules are there. Thousands, I'm sure. Many thousands. If you see most installed, 17,000 modules. Okay. So that gives you an idea of how much is out there. And these are actually released modules. Then there are sandbox modules too, which this is not showing. Full projects. If I go to all projects, including sandbox, 30,000. Okay. So, yeah. So, the rest are sandbox. Sandbox meaning people have their own like code, but they're not they don't think they're ready for prime time. So the code is sitting on Drupal.org. You can actually find it. You can download it, yes. But the creator of the code is not willing to commit enough time to make it a full module and, you know, support it properly. So that's the sandbox thing. Okay. So let's look at some modules. So the rest of the presentation is all about just exploiting modules properly. What modules are there? We have admin menu, module filter. You've already seen what they do. Devel generate, we have already used them. Path auto, let's start with path auto. So again, I'll be going full speed. Touch DL path, not even DL, why not EN path auto. It downloads path auto, and it also downloads its dependency, which is token module. I am going to disable my mod because, you know, I don't want to make that a part of everything that I'm doing. Also, I am going to change my default theme back to Bartik because I'm done showing you. So here, you go to appearance and make Bartik the default. So now my site is back to what it was at the beginning. Now I enabled path auto. Right now, if you see, these have node 49, etc. I don't want that. I want proper nice name derived from the title. So I just go to configuration, search and metadata, URL aliases, set some patterns. I will change this content to a token node content. Type machine name. I think that's the correct one. Let me be sure. Node content type machine name. Yep, that's correct. Okay. So I do that, and once I do save configuration, all future nodes, when they will be created, they'll get an automatic path. But what about the existing ones? So let's just generate. Let's delete all aliases first. all aliases gone, then regenerate them for nodes, for taxonomy terms, and for users. So once you do that, now these nodes, they have a nice URL. There must be two nodes with the same title in NIBH. So that's why, so if I remove this, yeah, see, two of them with the same title. That's why they had to dedupe them. So you go elsewhere, you see. And the machine name was used. Okay, cool. That's path auto. Keep going. Web form. Web form will take some time to describe, but that's okay. Web form is being downloaded. And so as you can see, Drush, trying to do this without Drush would take me at least 5 minutes, but maybe longer. But with Drush, it's taking seconds. Yeah, 5-10 seconds. And now I have add content. Let me add a web form. So web form is like a survey form. You create some survey article. Oh, sorry. And save it. Now you can add some components to it. You can say your name. It's a text field. Make it required or whatever. And that creates a form that anybody can submit. Right? If I submit that, this will show up in my results. Now, so there's my submission. Shows up in my results. You can send emails based on this. You can do a lot of things. The best part is you can write custom module that exploits this functionality for the front end and then does something very interesting on the back end, like, you know, e-commerce sales and whatnot. Okay, so that's web form. I'll keep going. WYSIWYG editor and CK editor. So you can, yeah. So right now, when you add a content article, let's say, there's no nice HTML editor for you. We can change that by downloading and installing CK editor. So CK editor and WYSIWYG is a generic module that can plug any what you get kind of editor, HTML editor, JavaScript library into Drupal, but this is just for CK. CK has been found to be slightly more usable, quick, easy to use. So there you go. All I had to do is reload, and I got nice CK editor. Now you can go into configuration, content authoring, CK editor, and see how it works. You can change the buttons that are enabled. So, yeah, you can change these buttons. But that's a detailed usage. You can do that. It's very easy. The CK editor just works out of the box. The WYSIWYG would take much more setting up and much more trouble. All right, so let's talk about color box, light box too, and so on and so forth. So if I get color box. So why do we use things like color box? Basically, so that some content or some forms can be presented in a modal, what a lot of people call pop-ups. It's not really pop-up, it's a modal, but okay. So let me show you an example of that. For example, galleries and pictures you want to show in color box. So I just enabled color box, and let's see if color box has all its dependencies. So if I go to modules, all, I guess somewhere in there should be color box. Yeah, so color box is there. Yeah, but does it have all the dependencies? Let's see if I configure. Looks like it does. So once I enable color box, right now my content when I go and display it, it shows just like an image, any other image, right? I can change that. I can go to structure, content types, article, manage display, and in default I can say the image is currently the format is image. You can show it as color box. So once you show it in color box, the image is being shown in color box. The original, the one that you will click on, will be one, and then it will be the, let's say, the thumbnail. Okay, show the thumbnail, and when they click on it, show them the original one, the full size one. Let's see if this works. Save, go to the home page, visit any article, and click on it. Okay, that didn't work. So it didn't actually bring up the color box. It actually displayed the full image in its own browser window, not in color box. That's because color box, I think it needs the color box library. So if I quickly...
Yes, it's not very good about telling you about its dependencies.
Yes.
I encountered that in a similar issue when I was using it.
Yep. So if I go to color box site, and then I guess I should download this. I copy this link address, and I'm going to download it here. So to install it, I go to libraries. So because it's an external library, and I say curl minus shift O, and this master.zip. So you got master.zip, and say unzip minus L master. First, I want to see what's... Oh, looks like it didn't actually download. Let me remove the master.zip. It probably did some redirection, so I need to follow redirect. Yeah, that's what it was. So now I have a more legitimate master.zip. Yep. So I will unzip it and rename colorbox-master to colorbox. That's it. Once I do that, hopefully reload. Nope, didn't work. Maybe
you need to disable it and enable it again, I think.
Oh, okay. Yep. Oh no, I didn't have it. So that's colorbox. So I had to flush caches. So which is the same thing. Disable enable would do similar things, but flush caches also helps. Okay, so now you have image showing in color box. If you had an array of images, multiple images, they will show up as a gallery. Okay, so that's color box. Let's see what else is there on our list. Link. So link, basically, we'll use link as part of other things, but basically it gives you a special field type. And that field type will, let's say if these were company logos and you wanted to link to the company websites, right? So you need a data field that contains the company website. So you could do that. So for example, you would say drush minus y and link. And now you can go into the content type, let's say article, and I will manage field, and I wanted to give a link to the source, original source of the article. I'm just making something up, okay? So if I say add a new field, the type is link and the widget is link, and I say source URL, let's say. Save, and say please list your sources. Okay, and I could make it multi-valued. Where is that? Yeah, number of values unlimited. And then I could say what title, you know, and the URL, those two things. There are a lot of other settings, we won't get into those, but let's just do this. So now I could go to any of the articles, let's say this one, and I edit it, and I can say, some of my sources are Google search, right? And then you maybe you Google for that nib, something like that. So then you could just, right? So you could specify, you know, google.com question mark q equals nibh. That search is it, right? So you can do that. I don't know what that is, okay. Something like slash q slash, is it? I don't know how it works, but I was hoping that there would be a simpler way. But okay, let's just say HTTP. Okay, you could add another item. Okay. Once you do that, you will be able to. It shows these two. So whatever you typed in the text title shows up here, but then it points to the underlying link, which is that. Okay, and you right now it replaces it. If you want to change that, you can say, hey, use target equal to blank, and open in a new window. Okay, so that's the link. Let's keep going. And views. Now, views is a big topic, but let's try to show as much as we can. So, views, I have views enabled actually. Resh minus y en views will tell me that it's already enabled because I enabled WebForm. WebForm uses views. So, but then when I look for views in here, I don't find it. That's what? No, the views UI is the module that needs to be enabled in order to do the administration UI. So now, if you refresh and look at the, yeah, there you go. That's the views UI. So now you can add a view. Now, there are lots of good tutorials on views. Views cannot be covered in such a short video. So let's just keep going. Views alone will take a whole day, at least a whole day to learn. But we'll not go there. Then there is view slideshow, bulk operations, a lot of things that you can learn within views. You should learn them. Then let's talk about MIMEMail. MIMEMail is something that will help you send HTML emails and emails with attachments. So we saw that. Let's skip. Advanced help is okay. Media is kind of important because it allows you to manage media files, images specifically. So the thing is about media is, oops, what happened? Something went wrong. Bundle property on entity type file, entity extract ID includes, it already has been sent, blah, 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 blah. Okay, this is obviously a problem. I don't know what that is. So let me just disable again. File entity, because media uses file entity, so I disable them both. Let's enable it again. I don't know if it helps. I have no idea if this will. Okay. Wait. No, not okay. I think it failed again, right? No, it didn't. No, nothing failed. Okay, yeah. So, good. It's successful. No errors this time. I don't know what it was doing last time. So now, once you have media module enabled, you can say that article content type, when it uses image, I want the image to be managed by media. So which means you go edit the field and change the widget type from image to media file selector. So So once you do that, when you are editing a module, an article I meant, you can say select media. So in the library, there are all these other files. These are all generated files. And you can say, hey, let's add a new item. Oh, by the way, looks like images are not multi-valued. Let's change that. So content types in articles, manage fields. Oh, I'm already there, sorry. I'm not there, I was there. Yeah, here, if I go to image, I should probably make it multi-valued. Yeah, save that. So once I do that, I can go to any article, edit it, and add multiple. So just say add another item, and then select media. From the library, just pick up some other media. And another one, let's say. So now I got three images. And I say save. And now these are the three images. But when I click on them, I should hopefully get a gallery of them, you see. I'm using arrow keys or two. Move around. That's pretty nice. So media basically gives you a better way. So now you're not always uploading new files. Earlier it was just uploading of files. That was the only thing you could do. You could not reuse media. Now you can use existing files. So that's very good. Okay, that's media. Then file field sources is similar. But I think in the presence size, file field sources also allows you to fetch your files from multiple places, upload included. But I think media does a better job. Date API is a long subject. You should know more about Date API. Suffice it to say that it gives you, there is another one, if I say Drush DL date. Then date project has multiple modules in it. Look how many. Date tools, 11 modules, by the way. Context, views, a whole bunch of things, including date, which is an API module. And then date pop-up is there. So you can use that too. So once you have enabled that, you will get a new field type. If I manage field on article, I can add a new field type. Okay, date is not listed there for some reason. Oh, I only downloaded, I never enabled it, sorry. So let me enable it. Reload. And now, I got a new type called date. Now you need to understand that there is date ISO and date ISO format and date Unix timestamp. They all have different meanings. This is more machine friendly. And the default date is more human friendly, and it all depends on your situation. And here you can say, how do you want to select date? You can enter a text field or you can use a select list. Let's say we have a new thing called publishing date of this article. I'll change the machine name to just date, because that way I don't have a multitude of dates, all kinds of dates. I can share this one. It's a publishing date, and you are capturing no hour and minute, let's say just date and day, month, day, year. So, or you can keep them, and there's nothing wrong with it. Let's keep it and collect an end date, no cache dates, yeah, sure, whatever. Take the defaults, number of values one. Let's save this, and now when you are editing articles or anything for that matter, you will be able to specify a date. So in this case, there is no calendar or anything. If you want to enable calendar, you have to say enable date underscore pop-up. So now once you enable date pop-up and refresh, nothing changes because the widget type is still text input. So you have to go back to, say, content types, manage field on article, and find that publishing date, edit it, and then say, hey, the widget I want to use is not a text field, but a pop-up calendar. This is a new one that came through. You continue and save it. Now, once you reload this page, you have a pop-up calendar. Okay. All right. So, that's, and this is the time. It just goes in increments of 15 seconds. It's 15 minutes, it seems. But yeah, so this is more user-friendly, right? Okay. Then, feeds. Feeds is very important. Actually, this is a module that allows you to import plain text, CSV, XML, that kind of data into your site. And that's very common for people to import. So I will do a very quick demo of that. So let's just see. I think feeds will take more time, so let's not do feeds on this. Let's keep going, actually. Feeds. Okay, flag. Flag is a good one. So, feeds, basically, let me tell you that feeds is used for importing text data into your site as nodes, as users, as terms, and so on. Okay, so that's what feeds is for. Let's do flag. Flag is very useful because it allows you to set a flag, a Boolean flag on certain things. So let me show you. Brush minus one and flag. So we got flag bookmark, flag, and flag actions. Okay, these are the modules that came with it. So flag actions is a lot of fun. It's a good, but we'll use it in a second. Let's start with flag alone. So once you enable flag, you can now define new flags. Okay, and there are no flags defined at this point. Let's say the flag is my favorite content. Easy stuff, right? So you just say add a flag. It should be able to flag what? Nodes, users, taxonomy, terms, file, or what? I'll say node. Okay, so a user is able to flag a node. And this will be, say, favorite. Title is favorite. Okay. Is it a global flag? What global flag means that it is not per user. Okay. So if this would be kind of promoted content, which is promoted for all users. So therefore, it's not a per user setting. But a favorite is not like that. My favorite is different from your favorite. A node may be my favorite, may not be yours. So therefore, it's a per user, that is a per user setting. So therefore, we will not make it a global flag. What is the link text? You say, and this is the text that will show up on the UI. Let's not change anything for now. I'm just going to take everything default. And you let's say you can only make articles as favorites. Okay. So I'm not, it's a lot of settings. I'll just save this flag. See what happens. Now when I go and visit any article, okay, I see flag this item. But flag this item is hard to understand what it means. So I will edit it and I say make it my favorite or something. Okay, so add this to favorites. Okay, that's like that. And then when you're unflagging it, you say remove from favorites. Right? Add to favorites and remove from favorites. So now once you specify like that, save the flag. And now you reload, you say add to favorites. So I flagged it immediately, Ajax ran and it added to my favorites, and now I can remove it, but where can I see my favorites? I don't know. Looks like there isn't a place for me to see favorites. So I can actually, that's a great point where I can show you the power of views. So I will quickly create a view called My Favorites. Okay, I create a new view called My Favorites. It's content. Yeah, sure. Tagged with whatever, newest first. Do you want to create a page? Yes. Should it be a menu item or a tab or something? Kind of makes sense. Create a menu link. Yes. It should be a menu. And it should be... No, not a menu link at least. Menu item. We'll get to it. So, yeah, items to... Let's take the defaults. Save. And continue to edit. And here, it won't be my favorites. I will put it under user. User's UID. They will be the favorites of the current... Whichever user you are looking at. So you may say, add a contextual. So before I go do anything, let's just add some content. Let us filter for a favorite. So we say, add a filter and look for something that is flagged as a favorite. I don't see that. Okay. Maybe there is a relationship to be added. So if I see add, and I see flag there. So basically, I want to take the node that I'm looking, the user that I'm looking at, and find all of his flagged items. So you say flags, has the node been flagged? Say yes. Apply. And then identify this flag, that's okay. So I'm adding flag field is required. What? Which flag? Oh yeah, this favorite flag. Okay. So now it is showing one node that has the flag on it. So if I, let's start with just saving this. This is not what I wanted to do, but let's start with it. So now when I go to my favorites page, my dash favorites page, I see if one of the nodes. If I favorite another node, let's see if it shows up here, right? If I go to webform one, and webform one cannot be favorited because it's not an article. Let's see this hero. So I say add to favorites. Now if I go back to my favorites, I see the original one and the second one got shown. So this way, but the good part would be if I could add that to my user page and it was per user. Right now, every user's favorite shows up in the same place. Okay, so I could say add a contextual filter and would look for use UID. So this is the contextual filter of currently logged in or whatever you in the URL name there is the UID. So add apply and say where do you get your UID from? And what? Okay. Yeah. So relationship, it's the user whose flag it is, I guess. So where do you get the UID from, it seems? Provide a default value. It will be the raw value from the URL. User ID from the URL. Correct. So this. Apply. That's one thing. Second thing is, you have to change the path to your user percent the UID. Because remember, you want to see it as a tab and user's profile. So user and then say favorites. So say this, and now instead of menu, you say I want a menu tab, and the tab title will be my favorites, and the description will be whatever, doesn't matter. Is there a menu? I don't think. The menu shouldn't matter. It's a menu tab. And display link in contextual. No. I think this should be enough. Let's see if this actually works. So now, when I go to my Hello Admin, my own user page, I got a new tab called My Favorites. The view showed up as a My Favorite. And when I go there, I see My Favorites. Hold on. But this is too much, too big. So let's edit this view. Okay. I'm editing the view. And what I'm going to do is, instead of showing entire content or even teaser, I want to show just the title. So I will say, show me some fields. And the only field that I'm going to add is title. Let's just save. And these two are my favorites. If I go and flag another one, something else as a favorite. So let's see. I'll just go to the front page and make something else my favorite. Let's say this Natu. Add to favorites. And now if I refresh my favorites, I got Nat. So that's the power of views and flag. I mean, you can do a lot more, of course. But, and I breezed through views also. I mean, I used contextual filters and I used relationships and whatnot. So, unfortunately, in a crash course, you don't get some depth. You at least now you know that there are certain things as a contextual filter and a relationship. Go into views and find out what they are. They're really, really useful, powerful things. Okay. Let's see if I should stop here or should keep going. I think there is no real end. Before I left, I wanted to show you panels because panels are extremely useful, very, very useful. So I will very quickly show you panels. So drush -yen panels. So once you enable panels, it will do a bunch of things. It downloads. Remember that to manage panels, you don't use panels, you use page manager. So let me show you what I mean by that. In structure, you don't go to panels. If you go to panels, you won't see something useful. You see something far more useful in page manager. So which I don't see in the page manager is not enabled. Page manager happens to be so there is no such thing as panels UI basically. So you go to C tools and enable page manager because that's what will be. So if you go to page manager, yeah, this one provides a UI and API to manage pages within the site. These are custom pages or customized pages. So page manager. Okay, now you have pages, structure pages. So let's create a new front page. They actually have a front page, don't they? Wait. No. So I can create first let me create a page, then I'll make it a front page. If I create a new page, and it's of type, variant type is panel. There is another type called HTTP response code for redirection and access denied kind of stuff. Okay. So any access control? No. Visible menu item? No. And selection rules? If there are conditions under which you want to show it or not show, like, you know, choose one over the other? No. Context. Context means adding extra data, such as nodes and users and flags and etc. You fetch other data from the current situation, current conditions, like who is the logged in user or what node am I looking at. I'm not going to do any of those things. Let's just create. So let's say administrative title, my new front page. The machine name will be front page, let's just say. Okay. And administrative description, forget that. And I will say front dash page or something. That's the path. Okay. And continue. Makes me choose a layout. I will do two column layout. Let's say this one, or maybe three column layout. Let's say this one, yeah. Okay, so continue.
Is this the home page or your front page?
Yeah, home page, front page, kind of.
There's a, why didn't you check the box for make this your home page?
On purpose. I wanted to show how to do it from outside that.
Okay.
Okay. So you say administrative title, etc. So you can specify a page, the ID of the body, some extra CSS code, extra CSS classes to be added to the body, or the ones if you want to remove something, that's also possible. Okay. So then you say continue. And here you got a nice layout. You can add whatever you want to it. I'm going to add some content here, and I could add some widgets, some blocks, that is, right? Let's say, I don't know what to add, so I'm just going to, on the right-hand side, I will say, add content, and say widgets recent content. Yeah, sure. Finish that. Let's just save and see what happens. So once you do that, you can now go to this path called front-page. And it has that. Now you may say, hey, well, how is this? This doesn't look very interesting. Well, first of all, you did not type this content. Second, you could add this recent content to the right as a block. Sure. But not to a specific page. You would have to come up with generic rules. Or add to all these places. Or you would have to say only this path. But here you can manage it all in one place. More importantly, you can also add custom content. So here, add content, add custom content, and I can say, welcome to my front page, and I can put any kind of arbitrary stuff in there. I just put some kind of arbitrary content. It can be, you know, make it bold or whatever you want to. Okay. So, save, update and save. And now, back here, you have the custom content. Now, you may again say, hey, but I could do this with an article, couldn't I? But wait, you don't have this kind of control over the article. And by the way, you can add multiple blocks like this. Here's another one. Section 2. This is your section 2. Update and save. And back here, remember this was welcome to my front page. Reload. Now you got another section 2. You couldn't do this in articles, because in articles everything would be a single block and everything goes in that body. Here you have 2. You can have 3. You can have 5, 10, 50, whatever you want. And similarly, you can put it in any box that you want to. So you can say, hey, left hand side. Oh, you know what? The section 2, I want to move that to left hand side. That's it. That's all that it took. Try doing this in an article. You can't. So panels gives you ultimate control over the layout. In fact, I haven't even shown you. It does far more than that. How about you wanted to say, for a logged in user, show this thing, but for a not logged in user, show something else, which is what you can do with variants. Okay, so you can say, let's clone this variant. Okay, so for we'll switch the content, switch the position. So clone the variant, and say anon page, front page. So you say, I copied the so this one I should now rename from just it's kind of panel is to so logged in front page for logged in user. Okay, Now you got front page for logged in user and anonymous user front page. But of course, the second one will never show up because it's we never added a rule. So we go into here and we say selection rules. Flag. Call to undefined. Okay, selection rules. Oh gosh. I will disable flag. Or dress CC all maybe. Sometimes that helps. No? Let's disable flag. Okay, so selection rules. So I'm just going to say user role is authenticated. So as long as the user is logged in, this variant applies. So keep in mind that it has to be before anonymous front page, because anonymous front page has no selection rule, so it will always pass. So you put the logged in front page in front of above the anonymous ones, so that this one is checked. If it doesn't pass, then it fails over to the second one. So we update save, and now when I see, let's make a difference change. The section 2 for anonymous is in the middle, let's say. So I go to content, and I say the section 2 is in the middle here, and then this guy, the welcome text is on the left for anonymous. So once I do that, I reload. I am logged in, so section 2 is on the left and my front page is on the right. And if I view the same page as not logged in, welcome is on the left, section 2 is on the mid. You see the difference? This is logged in, this is anonymous. Two different pages are served to two different people. So you can get very crazy with this. You can do all kinds of depending on the situation, your context. If you look at the selection rules, there are lots and lots of options. Let's see, selection rules. Here you can say content text exists, current theme is this, or am I on front? Oh, by the way, I never set it as front page. So you can set it as front page by going to system site information, and in there you say my front page is not node, it is front dash page. Save configuration. Now even if, when you hit home, it goes to my panel page. Okay, sorry. So that's what, so back to this, you know, in selection rules you can put some custom PHP code if you want. You can check for URL path, you can check for the bundle or whatever these things. I don't know what user bundle is, but you can get very fancy. Okay, so that's panels. Panels can do a lot more. I cannot even begin to describe how much it can do. Okay, so I hope this was good. This document is available publicly. You can just look at this. There are lots and lots of links. Okay, I will include the link to this document in when I post the video. Okay, hopefully that'll be good. All right, hope you had a good Saturday morning. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.